Okay, this is chapter 7. Basically, it's part 1 of design tools. There are lots of motherhood statements, and the main point here is that I'm sure everyone knows that you definitely need CAD tools for basically everything that you do in the ASIC SoC design area. A little bit of an introduction. Of course, there's been increased complexity, improved fabrication techniques, and it sort of goes hand in hand with CAD tools themselves, which free the designer from low-level tasks and lets the designer deal with higher-level tasks in chip design. So in this chapter, we'll take a look at some design tools, briefly discuss some of the algorithms, and maybe make a note that many of the CAD tools discussed in this chapter still deal with relatively low-level implementation issues. An idealized design environment would have a number of tools, a suite of tools that share a common database, and you'd like a mechanism to translate between the different tool vendors. And there are some of these mechanisms in place or netlists in place. One of them is called EDIF, if you see that name. It's for Electronic Design Interchange Format. And it's supposed to be a vendor-neutral format to store electronic netlists. That's kind of an idealized environment. Usually a number of vendor tools are employed for various aspects of the design, and the handoff is from one tool to another is a netlist, but it may not necessarily be all that standardized, such as with EDIF. Here's a little representation of a number of different design tools that are interacting with the database and sort of what tools you might use if you're in a particular area. So a layout editor, for example, when you're right down putting polygon layers on silicon effectively, you might be using a layout editor if you're doing micro machining MEM. So that's micro electromechanical system design. You'd still probably interact with some design rule checkers and perhaps have to even violate some design rules that would normally be in the process, such that you could build your part. If you're working for a design company, let's say that's fabless, you're still going to be using a number of tools like synthesis tools, analysis tools, verification tools, and simulators, and perhaps a number of translators. It's unlikely that you're using compaction tools, but it's unlikely you're actually into the nitty-gritty of these tools unless you're working for Cadence, Altera, or Xilinx, or Mentor, some of the big CAD vendors. Design entry tools, certainly it's an important aspect of chip design, and it has associated with it databases. Typically used to create, edit, and maintain design information, so that could be low-level design layout, some of the connectivity associated with that layout, which typically a netlist, and a very high-level representation perhaps would be the behavior, but that would be more likely the mode that you're going to operate in. With respect to the low-level design entry, probably a little less so. So regardless of the design entry medium, it's always nice to have a good user interface. Of course, if the tool is intuitive and easy to use, it'll be more likely to be used. And the other thing is that you really don't want a person having to relearn design tools all the time. Another point to make here is that a person who designs at the physical layer, low down at the physical layer, is unlikely to be the person designing at the application level or system design level. A completely different suite of tools are employed. But here we're going to talk a little bit about layout tools. Basically, they're editors that allow you to enter, modify, and maintain layout geometry. So you're basically they're drawing programs, and you're drawing relatively simple shapes that are used in IC design, and they're typically going to be polygons. So most layout editors have specific editing features for IC design, and typically they have to interact with the very least with design rule checkers and perhaps other tools. So that's a very, very low level, very close to the fabrication, and I mentioned before, it's the MEMS like or microfluidics lab on chips type of things, and you can certainly look up a bunch of those on Google if you like. With respect to logic, this is sort of what the basic low-level layout might look like for a couple of cells. There's an inverter, a NAND gate, a NOR gate, and then a chip down here that shows a number of logic block cells, I guess, that are wired together and then put in some type of a package that also shows the I/O. So it's not a package, it's just the layout editor, but at showing a relatively complex design, but that's still incredibly small. So desired features of a layout editor would be allow you to basically create geometries that were found in the masks themselves or the mask layouts. So most IC designs are concerned with simple polygons that you'd end up connecting up. Often the angles are restricted to something like maybe 45-degree angles, often only to 90 degrees. And an exception there might be an inductor in RF kind of design. Restricted to 45 degrees, usually limited by the particular technology, basically probably that associated with the mask making. But you may need the ability to make massive shapes with different angles than those, basically arbitrary angles. And here's a couple of examples of an integrated circuit inductor is probably used in the RF area. The nice thing about an inductor is that they still tend to look like inductors. Here's one that only had the 90 degree angles. These two here support 45, and this one here was arbitrary angle. And over here you see some of the 90 degree angle on some inductors that were built in silicon. Here's just an example of a micromachined copper inductor. This obviously had an arbitrary angle, and basically you can see it's not sitting on a substrate, it's sitting in air. But it does, you know, look like an inductor. It certainly has got the same kind of thing that you'd wind if you were winding wires to build an inductor. This over here is a photomicrograph of an accelerometer. So basically this inertial mass here sits over some type of a cavity that was etched away, and when it moves you're going to be able to detect that movement and determine whether you know, movement has taken place. There's just a picture sort of showing the scale of some micromachine parts and a mite. Anyway, layout tools should support hierarchical design. Hierarchical design just makes management of larger designs possible. That's new. That's not new, rather. That's from Descartes in the late 1500s or so. And obviously it encourages reuse of previously designed modules. Different levels of abstraction view should be supported for different design blocks. Certainly there's more than one way to express design information. Layouts views, for example, would be used for the mask geometries, the polygons, netlists for ASICs and SOCs, schematics perhaps more likely at the printed circuit board level, and then hardware description language code to describe your design at a high level. By and large, they're primarily used for connectivity information. And you'd like to have consistent management of different views. That would be desirable. Connectivity information should be maintained, as well as geometrical shapes. This isn't always easy to do. What you'd like to be able to do, though, is start working with objects which are different than just the low-level polygons. And in that case, you'd sort of treat the transistor as a unit itself. And one of the nice things you'd like to be able to do is when you pick up a transistor and move it on a layout editor, its connection should move with it, and move with it without violating design rules. So that's sort of the part that makes it difficult. It's not just the schematic, it's the actual representation of the low-level layers that are built on silicon. The program should also have flexible in its interface to other design tools. A layout editing tool by itself is of relatively limited use. You'd like to have it integrated with design rule checkers, circuit extractors, simulators. So those can be used to refine your design. For example, you might want to be able to back annotate from the low-level layout to capture stuff like the parasitic capacitances and resistances, which obviously are going to affect the performance of the circuit. So those should be closely tied to the layout program. The program should be relatively technology independent, or at least flexible enough to be able to migrate through a technology change, and typically that's done with a technology file. Obviously the rapid progress of fabrication would make a program obsolete quite quickly if it were tied to that one particular process. And as mentioned before, you really wouldn't want the designers to have to, you know, continually relearning new tools all the time. The other thing that you'd like to be able to support is parameterized cells. Parameterized cells, for example, would be those that allow you to have perhaps transistors within an inverter that the widths can be varied, so they have various amounts of drive associated with it. So you'd like that to be perhaps externally specified and then automatically generated. You obviously like to allow a couple different design methodologies, top-down or bottom-up design, and should be fairly flexible to accommodate both of those styles. For application-specific ASICs or SOCs, a designer is not very likely to encounter a layout editor. The designer be more concerned with the hardware description language view of the design, or perhaps even a higher level representation. I gave an example of hardware C. But layout tools are still essential if you're certainly designing leading edge products such as memory, GPUs or processors, in which case you're probably either working for Intel, AMD, or a variety of offshore companies, or specialized electronics design. For high-speed analog designs, the designer is usually concerned with considerable layout details. The layout not only affects area, which is often what you're trying to minimize when you're putting together a logic circuit, but you also have to be aware of other things that might take place on high-speed circuits, such as crosstalk or coupling, which typically are going to be layout issues. So those are not solved by back-of-the-envelope calculations. They're tied to electromagnetic solvers. With respect to design, many of the basic ideas behind design are very old. You can go back to Descartes or older. And one of the examples in there is divide and conquer. You divide a big project up into smaller ones that are more manageable, and you hope to be able to reassemble those to come up with a solution that will meet your specification. So most of the software that you've probably written or designed tries to take advantage of modern design practice. Not always the case in university. Often you're kind of crushed to do something in a hurry. But in any event, you're certainly well aware of what should be good design practice. So the in-class assignment 7.1 is, you know, what are some examples of modern design practice? And at this point in time, we'll take a quick break.